Let's get a reaction to the remarks of Finance Secretary Benjamin Doctor. We're now joined by RCBC's Chief Economist, Mike Ricafort. Mike, Happy New Year to you. Thanks for joining us today.
Hi, Happy New Year, Carmina and your viewers. Thank you for having me.
All right, so the Finance Secretary painting a very rosy picture for 2023. We'll get to that in a bit, but first, your assessment of 2022, missteps, what did we do right? Go ahead, Mike.
It's really, well, the biggest challenges emanated from the Russia-Ukraine war since February 24. That has really caused a lot of headaches around the world in terms of higher prices, higher inflation. We all felt that. But of course, the central banks, they did their job tremendously well. They tried to slow things down, enabled to, well, to fulfill their mandate of price stability. They raised rates, the policy rates. And of course, there were unintended consequences in doing so. Primarily, it's like stepping on the brakes for safety reasons, because they need to clamp down or better control or further ease inflation from elevated levels, especially in the US, coming from 40-year highs. Even our inflation is at a 14-year high of 8% right now. So, well, of course, that would definitely lead to higher borrowing costs for everybody, for consumers, for businesses, for industries, for the government also. And early this year, that also resulted in a stronger dollar because of the aggressive Fed rate hike. So, yeah, there were unintended consequences. But, yeah, it really emanated from there primarily because of that war. But they were kind of effective, though. Oil prices have already lingered to near one-year lows lately at around $77 for the NYMEX oil. So we started this year at $75. When the war started, it was already at $92. And the peak was $130. That's March 7. And the last time we saw it at relatively elevated levels was around $123 in the middle of July. There were already earlier, talks of reopening in China, but of course that didn't happen. We all know that it's just now that they're trying to reopen. And of course, there are still other challenges because of the reported large number of COVID cases in China. And we have seen already the likes of the US and Italy already requiring negative COVID tests for incoming passengers from China. So, there could be some upsetting factors. So would this lead to, say, another increase in cases worldwide or not because of the increased vaccination and booster doses plus the bivalent booster doses that are more effective supposedly for Omicron.
But we're going to talk more about that in a bit, Mike. But first, I want to just go back to what you said, the war in Ukraine being the biggest surprise of them all in 2022, really sent all the economies into a tailspin. But here's the thing, it doesn't seem that it's going to end soon. So what other headwinds might we expect from that, from the still ongoing war in Ukraine?
Yeah, true, Carmina. Actually, the central banks they've done a great job. They've brought down commodity prices, and of course, other than that, the aggressive Fed rate hikes, another important unintended consequence is the risk of recession. So far, the markets are pricing in around 50% chance. In the Philippines and maybe in other Asian countries, that may not happen. The least that we could get is a slowdown in the economic growth and recovery.
Why are you so confident that it's just going to be a slowdown and not a full-blown recession for the Philippines?
Well, if we go by the numbers, if you look at the various economic data in the Philippines, it has been kind of... They're kind of resilient, at least for the past 3 months or so, as the economy reopened further towards greater normalcy. In fact, we have no more restrictions now compared to a year ago or 2 years ago. Now, Well, the biggest manifestation is the optional wearing of face masks. And practically, the missing elements of the recovery that we have all been waiting for, they have reopened already, like foreign tourism since February 10. And they're delivering results already. And as well as local tourism, the further recovery with the easing of restrictions in recent months. And of course, the resumption of face-to-face schooling since August 22. So you could imagine the hard-hit related businesses and industries, they're now on the right recovery path. We have to be kind of patient though with other areas of the economy, but
let me just ask you this. Are you concerned that what we're seeing right now is sort of artificial? Because we know that a lot of people lost their jobs. We know that a lot of people are now buried in debt. And that the money that they're spending now actually came from the money that they borrowed. And this is eventually going to lose steam because eventually they're going to have to pay off that debt. They're going to have to need, more income as well to pay off that debt. What's your take on that?
Well, true, Carmina, because, the economy, we had one of the longest lockdowns. That's true. That may have led to either temporary or permanent closures of some business establishments. So, of course, but now with the reopening narrative, if you look at the data, we have seen resilience of some sorts. For instance, if we go by the numbers, of course, the economy is already back to pre-pandemic levels in peso terms at constant 2018 prices. So that's one. And the other supporting data, OFW remittances are near record highs despite the pandemic. Of course, because of the social function, the assistance during the pandemic, and as well as the assistance now because of higher prices. There's a need to, there's that need to send more to fill.
Exactly.
Yeah. And exports, surprisingly, are at record highs on the month. So those are bright spots, as we call them. And the trade deficit, accordingly, narrowed to the least in more than a year. Of course, it came from, before that happened, it came from record trade deficit levels because of the record importation, because it was bloated by higher commodity prices earlier this year. And then, of course, the reopening of the economy led to some pickup in importation. And we look at manufacturing, it's at the highest since the pandemic started. At some point, it even came from four-year highs. So it's kind of consistent also with the trade data, with the record exports. And the employment data, well, surprisingly, it matched the best levels. The employment rate at 95.5%, that's matching the record high. So, and correspondingly, unemployment rate, it matched the record low of 4.5%. So,
what about underemployment? They may be employed, but they're not taking home enough money, Mike.
Yeah, true. That's a very good point, Carmina, because, of course, we have to be patient on some businesses and industries. The recovery may not be as fast as we would want them to be because, of course, they're kind of patient also. Like, for instance, for some sectors, some of them have yet to really go back to pre-pandemic levels. For instance, for tourism, we haven't seen the large group of foreign tourists, say, from the biggest source countries like China. We don't see those big groups yet. So
let's get into that. Let's get into China. That seems to be really an issue now because of the surge in COVID numbers there, because they've relaxed all their restrictions all of a sudden. Now they're allowing travelers or Chinese nationals to travel abroad without restrictions. That's causing quite a scare in some countries. A scare that, the surge that's happening there might just happen within their own backyard. What's your concern, if any, regarding that? That as we look to 2023 to boost tourism once again, our largest, the largest market for Philippine tourism is grappling with a surge currently. and the scare that they might just bring this new variant in and might cause a surge here in the country. Does that concern you at all?
Well, of course, we don't want to be complacent about it. Learning from the lessons of COVID for the past 2 years or so. And definitely, there would be, of course, there would be safeguards also.
Is that going to be enough of a dampener for the prospects of the Philippine tourism industry? Because we were really looking to really open up. Go ahead.
Yeah, true. Because that's a missing element. We're really waiting for the large group of foreign tourists, especially from China and other Asian countries, at least an escape from the winter and just simply going on holidays. So, that would somewhat delay the recovery on the tourism sector, because that's one of the growth drivers, and the country is really counting on that. Because in terms of the generation of jobs, the potential to really catch up with the rest of ASEAN, because we all know in terms of number of tourists and tourism revenues, so we really have to, the country has yet to really catch up. And of course, that's presenting a lot of opportunities going forward. Yeah. But realistically, no, that could be delayed. That's the least that could happen. And maybe another risk factor, of course, is a potential spread of COVID again. Though this time it's different because they're already a large number of people fully vaccinated and even boosted. And of course, the country has yet to really wait for the new booster dose, the bivalent. The bivalent one. That's
but Mike, we also have to say that even if we wait for the large numbers of tourists coming from China, the tourism industry performed very well in 2022.
Yeah, true. At least it only resumed since February 10. So we have seen very encouraging numbers, and that's one of the growth drivers actually going forward in terms of job generation, and of course, for them to recover further from, because they're among that industry among the hardest hit during the pandemic. And of course, we all know the trickle down effects, especially in the key tourist destinations and in the adjacent areas and many other in the supply chains. Those are at least that's one growth driver, and of course productivity gains as well in, for instance, in agriculture, as well as in manufacturing. Mm-hmm. So going forward, if the country is to reach the middle income status, and why are these sectors very important? For agriculture alone, it employs nearly a quarter of total workers in the country. And we all know they're situated in the countryside, in the rural areas, where realistically, where poverty incidence is present, and there's a need really to bring down poverty incidence. And for the manufacturing sector, it employs close to 20% of the total workforce in the country. So if that is intensified further, so that's gonna really drive or increase incomes, spending power, and the Philippines itself. If you look at for instance, the other growth driver, OFW remittances. That's the Philippines is number 4 in the world after China, India, and Mexico. For a time, the country even exceeded Mexico about 5 years ago. That's already moving towards $40 billion per year. Mm-hmm. And the BPO industry also, it has grown tremendously over the years. And it's kind of contrarian in the sense that whenever there are economic downturns and recessions, the BPO industry picks up because there's a greater need and exigency for global firms to stay competitive, to outsource and save on costs. So that's earning more than $30 billion per year, and still the prospects are still bright, even according to the industry association. It could even employ additional 1 million workers from the current 1.4 million BPO workers, and the revenues is even projected to grow towards $50 billion.
And all of these things that you just mentioned really bolsters your optimism that despite the global headwinds, external headwinds that are about to come in 2023, all these that you mentioned is going to be enough to serve as buffers for the local economy?
Yeah, true, Carmina, definitely. Because we have favorable demographics also, more than 110 million Filipinos. That's the 12th largest economy in the world. And the average age is 25, so relatively young population. And we already reached a demographic sweet spot since 2015. Meaning majority of our population is already working age. It's more than 50 million. So imagine, the Philippines is one of the last major Asian economies to reach that stage. Mm-hmm. Meaning like Japan was 50 years earlier, Hong Kong and Singapore since 1980, South Korea since 1985, China since 1990, and other ASEAN countries were earlier by between 10 to 10 years than the country. So and we all know what happened to them right after. A tremendous growth. Because imagine majority of their population productive, they're earning, they have spending power, they would start families, they would send their children to school, they would buy houses, higher multiplier effects.
Right, but inflation wasn't as high as inflation is at this point during that time. So when you talk to the regular folk, they're talking about inflation. They're talking about the prices of onion. There's an egg shortage, Mike, and this is going to stabilize middle of next year, so they say. So how does that all fit into this rosy picture that the finance secretary is painting and that you yourself share with the finance secretary?
Well, true. Those are valid risk factors and concerns, Carmina. Inflation, everybody else feels that. We have seen not only here in the Philippines, but around the world. Like in the U.S., it came from 40-year highs. In other developed countries, it's even more than 10%. Here in the Philippines, it's 8%. We're kind of near with the global trend. So, if you are to really try to come up with a balanced approach to everything, it looks like that the reopening narrative, the country moving towards greater normalcy, that so far overshadowing the risk of higher prices and of course the recent weaker peso that also added to inflation, because the peso still weakened by close to 10% since the start of the year. Of course, that's adding to prices of imports like oil and other commodities that since the country is a net importer. And of course, higher interest rates. So, for instance, like the other data, like loans, loan growth in the country, it's among the fastest in 4 years, at around 14% year. The non-performing loan ratio improved to the lowest in more than 2 years. So it goes to show that, maybe the best way to understand this is that one to 2 years ago, same time of the year, many people are just praying to get greater normals for at least to have a resolution to this COVID problem. And now, back then, the problem was the lack of jobs, there were job losses, the loss of livelihood, less sales, less income for companies, and less employment. But now the challenge now, of course, with the jobs already returning, the livelihood, and also more sales for companies and industries, more income, more employment opportunities, and other business opportunities. So now the problem, it looks like at least it's more manageable to tackle higher prices than 1 to 2 years ago when the problem was the lack of livelihood, reduced sales, reduced incomes, and reduce livelihood. So, maybe that's really another way of looking at it on a more, from a perspective of a scenario of a glass half full rather than glass.
So basically you're saying you agree with the finance secretary that the worst is over, but hold up, we're not there yet, right? We're just beginning to get there. One last point, Mike. You've got the lowered tax rates, right? Which means more spending money for the people, but less for the government. At the time when it needs it the most to spend for the services that the people need the most. How is this not going to be a problem as we go into 2023?
Well, at the very least, Carmina, well, it's by, maybe it's really a good coincidence of some sorts because, with the inflation problem, this is one way to mitigate that. There would be many people, a lot of people would have higher take-home pay starting January of next year because of the reduction in individual income tax rates under the train law. So yes. That would help mitigate it. Yes, that's one. It would help boost consumption, and of course there would, but of course it would come at, well, with some price. Like of course the government, that would mean reduce tax revenue collections, especially now that the government incurred a lot of debt during the pandemic. That's already nearly 6 trillion. That's 2 trillion per year. That's the average, 2020, 2021, and this year. So that's 6 trillion.
So is this going to be a problem for the government, Mike? What do you think?
Well, the only thing that we really have to, well, of course, the increased take-home pay by consumers would mean they would spend more. Of course, if they spend more, that would mean more collections of VAT, value-added tax, or the sales taxes. But of course, realistically, some of which would also go to savings. That would be, of course, another challenge. All the more that the fiscal reform measures and the tax reform measures must be passed. At the very least, intensified tax collection. And then if inflation stabilizes, we may see new taxes, higher tax rates. We have seen that at least for three different administrations previously. Mm-hmm. They were able to tackle it successfully. They were able to bring down the debt-to-GDP ratio from more than 70% of GDP almost 20 years ago to as low as 39.6% of GDP. That's the lowest in recent memory. That's why the country was upgraded to investment grade for the first time since 2013, and that was sustained with further upgrades in the credit ratings to 1 to 3 notches above the minimum investment grade. And the country has maintained that because of that, it came from a relatively strong fiscal position to start with in 2019. And it's very important now to also going forward. Of course, that's on the spending side, to discipline spending, anti-leakage, anti-corruption, and anti-wastage. At the same time, prudent spending, especially on the big infrastructure projects. Some rationalization as to the cost-benefit analysis, the greatest benefit of that would be prioritized, and preventing white elephants. And at the same time, on the spending side, it's the right sizing of the government. So they're all, a lot of them are legislative reform measures already being already gaining ground in the lower house at the very least. So in the coming year, let's see if a lot of those would be delivered. The foundations are already there. Let's see eventually it will. It's like planting seeds. Eventually, from a policy standpoint. As we mentioned, for many areas also, not only the reform measures, but agriculture, manufacturing, it's planting the seeds. Hopefully, it will bear fruit in the coming months.
All right.
As early as 2013. So, yeah. So, it's really, at least the foundations are there. We have a credible, competent economic team with good track record of delivery. So, now it's a matter of everybody's waiting on the delivery of the reform measures and the other, of course, they know.
All right, Mike. So sorry, but we ran out of time now. I'm going to have to cut you there, but we do appreciate all the time and the insights you've given us this afternoon. Thanks again. Mike Ricafort there, the chief economist of the Rizal Commercial Banking Corporation, or RCBC. Thanks again, Mike. Happy New Year to you. Have a prosperous one.
Thank you so much, Carmina, and to our viewers. Happy New Year.